الشباب ده هيجي وده قدموا كده.
Chronic hep C or chronic hepatitis B as a major indication for
political transfer. However, in the Western countries, like in Europe or America, this sometimes the first indication for joint liver transplant was end-stage liver disease complicating alcoholic liver disease. We should know the etiology of liver disease because the post-operative care depends mainly on the prevention of recurrence of the primary liver disease or knowing the etiology of the primary liver disease. So, simply, what are the indications for chronic liver disease can be chronic liver failure or chronic liver disease complicating by chronic liver failure due to chronic alcoholism, due to viral hepatitis, due to autoimmune hepatitis, due to metabolic liver diseases, or acute liver failure. We call it fundament liver failure. If we have manifestations of acute liver failure with hepatic encephalopathy developing or brain edema, this gives the definition of acute liver failure. That is liver failure in a previously normal liver with acute ulcer complicated by hepatic encephalopathy. This may be due to viral, toxin, or alcohol. However, acute liver failure is a major indication for liver transplantation. Sometimes the underlying liver disease is neoplastic lesion. We have two common primary liver malignancy. As you know, from the Western point of view, liver neoplastic lesions are usually in the Western countries secondary to primary gastrointestinal neoplasm. So the commonest cause of malignant liver in Western countries has been reported to be due to presence of secondaries. That is to say, tumor originating outside the liver from the gut, from the lung, from the breast. These are the commonest neoplastic lesions in the liver in Western countries. However, the primary liver neoplasms are two common tumors, which are hepatocellular carcinoma arising from hepatocyte or cholangiocarcinoma arising from cholangiocyte. Which type of primary liver neoplasm is an indication for liver transplant? It is usually the primary hepatocellular carcinoma, not cholangiocarcinoma, not metastatic neoplastic liver lesions. So, hepatocellular carcinoma is an indication to do liver transplant. But which stage of hepatocellular carcinoma can be good candidate for liver transplantation? As you know from pathology and from your previous studies, the bad thing about malignancy is recurrence. That is to say, if you cure the primary neoplastic lesion, you have expectations that this primary can recur after time, after a while. And this recurrence usually shortens patient survival, and it would be catastrophic for the patient. In order to avoid the high recurrence of hepatocellular carcinoma after doing liver transplantation, there have been some limitations to patients with hepatocellular carcinoma to perform liver transplantation in order to have the best results, the best patient survival, the least recurrence rate of the primary hepatocellular carcinoma. There have been many criteria literature. However, the most validated, the most useful, the most used criteria, selecting patients with underlying hepatocellular carcinoma to do liver transplantation are two. The first criteria, which is called Milan criteria, and according to this Milan criteria, the good candidate for liver transplant with underlying hepatocellular carcinoma, if there is a unifocal lesion with a diameter, with its maximum diameter less than 5 cm, or presence of 3 lesions in the liver, 3 neoplastic lesions in the liver. However, each lesion has a maximum diameter of 3 cm. If we have a solitary lesion in the liver with its maximum diameter, transverse or vertical diameter, is less or equal to 5 cm, we can do liver transplantation. If the patient has multicentric or multifocal hepatocellular carcinoma, usually 3 lesions only, with each lesion's diameter, its maximum diameter less than 3 cm, we can do liver transplantation. The other Milan criteria, there should be no distant metastasis. That is to say, the primary lesion has no distant metastasis. There is no macrovascular invasion. That is to say, there is no malignant thrombus in the portal vein or in the hepatic veins. Or there is no local infiltrative disorder or disease. That is to say, if it is high up in the dome of the liver, there is no diaphragmatic infiltration. Or if it is lower down, there is no infiltration of the kidney, of the colon. So, if we have a solitary lesion, 5 cm or less, with no distal metastasis, with no local infiltration, with no visible macrovascular invasion, this is a good candidate for liver transplantation. Or, on the other side, if we have 3 lesions, each less than 3 cm, with no local infiltration, no distant metastasis, no macrovascular invasion, this is also a good indication for liver transplant. According to what? According to Milan criteria. There has been modification about Milan criteria, put forward by University of California and San Francisco. So this is UCSF, University of California and San Francisco. This is the famous criteria. It depends mainly on Milan, but with extension of this diameter from 5 cm for those with solitary lesion to 6.5 cm. And if it is multifocal, it is not necessarily should be 3 focal lesion. However, the sum of the maximum diameter of this multifocal lesion should not exceed 9 cm. So as you see, there has been some elasticity in determining the diameter, the number of the lesion, and however, within a limitation. Okay? So these are the indications for liver transplantation. Chronic liver disease with manifestation of end-stage liver failure or acute liver failure, or we call it fulminant liver failure, with no chance of spontaneous recovery, this is an indication, or if there is underlying primary hepatic neoplasm in the form of hepatocellular carcinoma under certain criteria. What are the other indications? So we have amyloidosis. You have studied in pathology, amyloid disease, and it could be primary or secondary. What we mean about, what we are concerned about is the primary amyloid polyneuropathy, which is a disease due to secretion of abnormal protein from the liver which is deposited in the nervous system, leading to devastating neurological deficits, quadriparesis, quadriplegia, peripheral neuropathy, and so on. In this situation, patients present to the neurologic department with a serious neurologic disease. However, the etiology of this underlying serious neurological irreversible disease is a normally functioning liver but secreting abnormal protein. You know this? So, if we plan to cure this patient, we have the choice to remove this liver, although it's normal, functionally perfect. The patient has no ascites, the patient has no jaundice, there is no elevation of liver enzyme, there is no encephalopathy, there is no underlying malignancy. So all this perfect normal liver, but we remove it because it secretes abnormal protein, leading to a systemic neurological disorder. This is an individual. This disease is fortunately uncommon in our locality. It's present usually in South America, in Argentina especially. I don't know why, they don't know why. Some few reported cases in France, in UK. But this is an indication of liver transplantation. The other one, so in primary amyloid world neuropathy, the liver secretes abnormal protein. Sometimes the liver is deficient in specific enzymes, leading to another disease like kidney disease, as in cases of primary oxalosis. In case of primary oxalosis, patients, usually children or infants, present with chronic renal failure. And if you go through the investigation, you find the kidney is full of oxalate crystal, leading to interstitial nephritis and the oxalate stone formation, leading to hydronephrotic kidney, and leading at the end to destruction of the kidney due to excessive oxalate deposition. So the patients or the children presented to you present with renal failure. However, if you are going to correct this renal failure by doing simply kidney transplantation, you have only transient recovery period of few months, then the new kidney is destroyed by oxalate crystal because the defect is not in the kidney. The defect is due to enzymatic deficiency in the liver, which is, again, normal. Looks normally, perfectly functioning well, but has a serious enzymatic deficiency leading to excessive oxalate deposition in all body tissue, even in the cornea, leading to chronic renal failure. So if we correct this chronic renal failure by doing kidney transplantation, the new or the transplanted kidney would be destroyed later on. So how can we solve such a problem? We find the etiology of renal failure. If it proves to be oxalate deposition due to enzymatic deficiency in the perfectly locking liver, you should do liver transplantation. And there is a debate about chronology of management of liver transplantation, whether should we do liver transplantation first, or should we do kidney transplantation first, or can we do what's called combined liver and kidney transplantation simultaneously. So if the patient presents with chronic renal failure, it's better for you to do combined liver-kidney transplantation. If there is a lag, you can do first kidney liver transplantation followed by kidney transplantation. Anyway, the combined liver and kidney transplantation is indicated in such patients. Or sometimes underlying cirrhosis due to Budd-Chiari syndrome, and maybe you have studied the vascular disorders of the liver, which is the commonest one is Budd-Chiari. We have also renal occlusive, sometimes it's an indication for liver transplantation, but in butt cavity, we have the venous outflow structure at the level of the hepatic vein. So these are other indications for liver transplantation. Another prospect of liver transplantation or indication of liver transplantation is impaired quality of life in patients with chronic liver disease. However, they haven't reached the stage of liver failure, such as in cases with primary biliary cirrhosis. Sometimes the ladies present with intractable itching or intractable pruritus, and in this case, if it fails medical therapy, even without manifestations of liver failure like ascites or jaundice or encephalopathy, we can do liver transplantation because of this impaired quality of life, or because of she has developed multiple spinal fracture or multiple bone fracture due to advanced osteoporosis. You know this. You know, osteoporosis can be the single presentation of primary biliary cirrhosis. Ladies come to you through the osteopathic department with abnormal fractures in the spine or neck femur, and it proves to be due to primary biliary cirrhosis. In such a case, even in absence of stigma of chronic liver failure, you should do liver transplantation. What are the contraindications to do liver transplantation? We can subdivide the contraindications into absolute contraindications and the relative contraindications. The absolute one is presence of comorbidity with HIV disease or HIV virus. And we should discriminate between HIV disease and HIV seropositivity. HIV disease, the patient presented with the full-blown picture of HIV disease or AIDS in the form of intractable, the chronic diarrhea, cachexia, opportunistic infection by monolysis of the gut, Kaposi sarcoma or opportunistic neoplasm, myopathy, peripheral neuropathy, hepatopathy, nephropathy even. And in this advanced stage, it's better not to do liver transplantation because the higher incidence of complications and the shortened survival after liver transplantation. However, if there is only HIV seropositivity, that is to say antibodies are present without the clinical manifestations of HIV disease that I have mentioned now, and the T lymphocyte set, which is called CD4, more than 200 per cubic milliliter, we can do liver transplantation. So, almost 5-6 years ago, we used to exclude, or internationally, used to exclude any candidate for liver transplant with HIV seropositivity. However, recent studies have shown that if this seropositivity is not associated with the clinical manifestation of HIV disease, you can do it successfully. Liver transplant condition is that you would offer the highly active antiretroviral therapy after transplantation, which is a very costly and very effective medication. Anyway, HIV disease is an absolute contraindication to do liver transplant. The other absolute contraindication is active alcohol or illicit drugs abuse or use. Active alcoholism in Western countries, sometimes the second most common indication for liver transplant is alcoholic liver disease. So if we offer the patient a new liver, which he gives, a new line for him, and he is stubborn to quit or to give up alcohol intake, he insists on taking alcohol again, he would destroy such a new liver, leading to cirrhosis and the necessity to do retransplantation again. In Western countries, so they refuse to do liver transplant unless the patient give up alcohol or illicit drug intake. Okay? Presence of extrahepatic malignancy is an optional contraindication to do liver transplant. So, in the initial workup of the candidate for liver transplant, you should exclude presence of tumors of the gut, tumors of the lung, tumors of the kidney, because presence of such an occult neoplastic lesion would lead to deterioration and rapid progression of this neoplastic lesion after liver transplant, because you give the patient heavy immunosuppressive drugs, bravo. And this immunosuppressive drugs given post-operatively to patients with liver transplant can give a chance to de novo malignancy to, formation. That is to say, any mutant cells in the skin or the gut under immune suppression, if you cause paralysis of the immune system, you would stop the immune surveillance process or immune surveillance function that destroys dysplastic or mutated cells. You know this? So if we cause paralysis of this immune system after liver transplant and the patient carry or high power an occult neoplastic lesion, it will progress at an advanced stage rapidly, leading to exaggeration or deterioration of patient condition. So we should do all investigation preoperatively to exclude presence of concomitant underlying serious neoplastic lesion. What is the other contraindication? Is presence of primary hepatic neoplasm but not hepatocellular carcinoma. The other one, which is cholangiocarcinoma. So if we have a focal lesion in the liver, you should first determine its nature, whether it is hepatocellular or cholangiocarcinoma. Because cholangiocarcinoma has a high propensity or high incidence of local recurrence immediately after transplantation. And it's a devastating disease with distant metastasis early. So it is an absolute contraindication to do liver transplant if the underlying primary hepatic neoplasm is cholangiocarcinoma. This is for you. But recently there has been some clinical trials using radiation chemotherapy pre-transplant to do for small lesion of cholangiocarcinoma liver transplant, but this is out of your scope. You should insist on differentiation between hepatocellular carcinoma and cholangiocarcinoma before transplantation, and if it proves it to be cholangiocarcinoma, this is, should be considered an absolute contraindication to do liver transplantation. The other one is presence of sepsis. It's logic to think that if the patient has serious sepsis or sepsis, we cannot offer him immunosuppression, because this would lead to high mortality of the patient. So presence of sepsis before liver transplant should be treated. So we cannot do liver transplant for a patient with lobar pneumonia. We cannot do liver transplant for a patient with meningitis. We cannot do liver transplant for a patient with spontaneous bacterial peritonitis unless treatment of this infectious condition. If the patient has advanced cardiopulmonary disease, like congestive heart failure, ischemic heart failure, dilated cardiomyopathy, concomitant with interstitial pulmonary fibrosis or emphysema pes lung, or so, this is a contraindication to do liver transplantation. But we can do what's called multi-organ transplantation simultaneously. We can arrange to offer this patient heart lung transplantation along with the liver transplantation. Okay? So before doing liver transplant, you should assess the liver, the cardiac function and the respiratory function as well. What What are the relative contraindications? What do we mean by relative contraindication? Relative contraindication is something that you, some centers can refuse to do liver transplant while others can do it. It's relative. It depends on the facility of the centers, the expertise of the surgeons, the expertise of the ICU, the equipment, logistics of this center, if we have an advanced life support center or not advanced ICU. So if you expect serious post-operative complications that you cannot deal with effectively, you always exclude such a patient. But if this the same patient goes to another center, he may be accepted for liver transplant. This is what we mean by relative. It is subjective evaluation, in other words. So, what are the relative contraindications? Advanced age. Because the definition itself of advanced age is not being well defined. You can consider the patient after 70, advanced age, or after 60, or after 80, advanced age. And since the Western population has been or has become an aged population, they usually do liver transplant for at advanced age rather than our country. So they may discuss if the patient is 65 or 70, they can do liver transplant. In other centers, they can discuss if the patient between 70 and 75, can they do liver transplant. What is the problem of age issue? The problem is that the higher the age, the higher the incidence of neoplasm. And if we offer concomitantly to this elderly patient immunosuppressive drugs or medicine, it will logically lead to more development of neoplasm. This is the first. The second one is that the other organ system usually cannot tolerate the drugs, the operation, the complications of this procedure. So advanced age can be considered. In our center, we can consider relatively patient between 60 and 65 is relative contraindication. However, after 65 is absolute. In America, they consider between 65 and 70 relative contraindication. After 70, it's absolute, and so on. So this is an issue of debate. Advanced cachexia. If the patient presents to you with advanced cachexia, the complication, post-operative complication, early after the operation are high in the form of sepsis, pneumonia, because he has no intercostal muscles, he has weak diaphragms, he has poor metabolic functions, so they cannot usually tolerate this procedure. So advanced cachexia, اللي احنا بنقول عليها بالعربي بتلاقي العيان جلد عرق جلد عرق. This is a contraindication to do the procedure unless you correct the underlying poor nutritional status. Chronic renal failure. As I mentioned earlier, we can do liver transplant, so we can do it for correction of this liver failure. But if there is concomitant renal failure, it would be worsened. It would result in serious complications early post-operative. So, if the patient has both liver and kidney failure, it's better to do combined liver-kidney transplantation simultaneously. No way. You cannot do kidney transplantation if the patient has liver failure. You cannot do liver transplantation only if the patient has concomitant chronic renal failure. So, this is a relative contraindication. We cannot do, offer the patient both liver and kidney simultaneously in the same session at our center, but in America, in Europe, they can offer the patient simultaneous post-organ transplantation, kidney and liver. So as you see, if I have a patient to come to me with liver failure, with chronic renal failure, I should refuse her. But if he is is abroad in Europe or in America, they will select him for combined surgery, combined liver and kidney transplant. So this is not an absolute contraindication, this is a relative contraindication, depends on local facility and expertise of the liver transplant team. History of bladder cancer. If the patient has previous neoplasms that been successfully treated with a surgery, surgically, or chemically by chemotherapy, or radiologically by radiotherapy, and this has been a long time elapsed between the presentation and this cure of the neoplasm, and this period ranged from more than 10 years with no relapse of the primary neoplasm, you can consider it for liver transplant. We can consider him at our center, but in other center, they say after 5 years with cancer-free recurrence, you can offer him. So this is an issue of debate. If the patient has well-known curative cancer like Hodgkin disease or aggressive non-Hodgkin lymphoma, which are curable, and they present to you 10 years later, you do all investigation to the, exclude presence of occult lymphoma tissue, you can do liver transplantation. Okay? So this history of bladder cancer. Sometimes we have a patient with cancer colon, cancer breast, or cancer prostate present to you with liver failure. And if there is, if it is a recent procedure, we exclude it because he is still in the period of probability of recurrence of primary neoplasm. And if we offer him immune suppressive drugs, it would probably increase the incidence of recurrence. So we would exclude such patients with a period less than 5 years. Multisystem organ failure, as I mentioned, we can't offer liver transplant for patients with concomitant respiratory failure, heart failure, kidney failure, or even bowel failure, call it small bowel failure, unless you can do concomitant multivisceral transplantation, like small bowel transplantation, with kidney transplantation, with pancreas transplantation, and liver transplantation. And such condition, it's a relative contraindication. I don't do it in our locality or in our center in Mansoura, but in America, if you are in Pittsburgh, you would successfully do multivisceral transplantation of the bowel, of the pancreas, of the kidney, of the liver simultaneously. Inadequate family or social support. This is a costly procedure. This is a very expensive procedure with very expensive medications post-operatively. The cost of liver transplant to recipient after transplantation, our locality ranges around 5,000-7,000 Egyptian pounds per month during the first year. Okay? So if he has no insurance, or if the state or if the government does not cover him with insurance, he cannot afford such expensive post-operative medication. So, if the patient has no social guarantee to do liver transplant, you should find financial resources to the patient to cover his post-operative medication costs. Or if social support, of course, you can't do liver transplant for those with no friends, no family member, has no social members can stand by him. You can do liver transplant for him, of course, but he would suffer a lot afterwards. Types of liver transplantation. This is an interesting issue. What is the source? I mean, give me a liver and a nice conductor concept. What is the source of this graft? What is the source of this liver which comes from? Where it comes from? We can get the liver, the whole liver from recently dead body who are healthy and have no serious infectious disease. فخير مثلا كده حالات الكار اكسيدنتس or during war. Young effect healthy حصل له car accident or during the war young effect healthy وجاله gunshot in the head مثلا. في الحالة دي احنا ممكن نلجأ لكذا اسلوب. احنا بنسميه كاديفر، كاديفر اللي هو الدد، فهيبقى كاديفرك يعني جاي من الكاديفر. الكاديفر ده نوعين، نوع اسمه هارت بيتنج كاديفرك ليفر ترانسبلانت، ونوع تاني اللي هو نون هارت بيتنج كاديفرك ليفر ترانسبلانت. ايه بقى الفرق بينهم؟ الكاديفرك ليفر كاديفرك هارت بيتنج ليفر ترانسبلانت عباره عن ايه؟ سوري
تقريبا بعد
15
دقيقه
من الوفاه. انا هقول لك 5 دقائق. الهارت بيتنج بيبقى كاديفرك هارت بيتنج ده بيبقى عيان يوجوالي في الاي سي يو في هوسبيتال قاعد عندك في المستشفى في الاي سي يو وحصل له برين تيست وريبورتد وانفستيجيت ان هو بقى برين تيست وهو just vegetative state يعني ماشي على nutrition parenteral nutrition وventilator respiration وvascular restrictor to support cardiovascular system and still his heart is beating and this beating heart although this person has beating heart he has no brain impulses he has complete brain death. بيعملوا له investigation to evaluate brain death, evoked visual, evoked auditory potential, MR, isotope, الكلام ده كله ويشوفوا brain metabolic activity. If there is no brain metabolic activity, if there is no sign of brain activity, in spite of this, his heart is still beating, he's still on ventilator, so there is respiratory movement. And kidneys function well, blood pressure is okay. In such a condition, we call it heart beating cadaver. ليه بقى؟ لأنه هو في الحالة دي يعملوا عليه عملية، عملية إيه بقى؟ إن هم ياخدوا الليفر. هياخدوا الليفر وهياخدوا الكدني وهياخدوا البانكرياس وهياخدوا السمول باول وهياخدوا الهارت وهياخدوا اللنج وهيقفلوا على السباين بس. ده اسمه إيه؟ هارت بيتين كدافير ليفر ترانسبلانت. ده بيحصل في بقى في العيانين اللي هو جاله وقع على راسه جاله هيماتوما او جاله ماسيف سيربرال هيموريج او جاله جان شوت في الانزهاد والعيان هوسبيتالايزد وموجود في الاي سي يو وبقاله 48 ساعه with all investigation done to prove that there is no metabolic activity in the brain whatsoever. And the patient has no infectious disease, ma'andush AIDS, ma'andush B or C, ma'andush A, meningitis, ma'andush pneumonia, يبقى في الحالة ده هو هيبقى كاتيفر. هيتاخد منه الليفر امتى؟ بعد ما افصل الاجهزة؟ لا، قبل ما افصل الاجهزة. هيتاخد منه كدني امتى؟ قبل ما افصل الاجهزة. يبقى هفضل اخلي الهارت بيتنج وبيتعمل له ديسكشن عادي خالص زي اي عيان. يتعمل له ديسكشن ويتشال ويتحط كلامبات على البورتال وعلى الهيباتيك ارتري وعلى الاي بي سي ويتاخد الليفر از ا هول ويز اول اتس فاسكولار اند بيلري ستراكشرز. وفي الحاله دي بعد ما نتاخد الاورجن يفصلوا عنه اجهزه التنفس والفاسكونستريكتور. يبقى ده اسمه ايه؟ هارت بيتنج. طيب ايه النوع الثاني؟ نون هارت بيتنج. نون هارت بيتنج عيان عامل سي كار اكسيدنت وصل المستشفى وهو على باب المستشفى ارستد دايد او هو عمل الحادثه من هنا ودخل والدكاتره حاولوا ينقذوه حصل له ارست على الترابيزه. يبقى العيان ده عنده هارت بيتنج ولا ما عندوش هارت بيتنج؟ ما فيش هارت بيتنج. في ريسبيريشن ولا ما فيش ريسبيريشن؟ طب ده دايد. ابرنتلي از يونج هيلثي اند there is no contraindication. هيعملوا له فحوصات بعد كده بس نقدر ناخد الاورجن ده ولا ما ناخدوش. عيان زي في الصين ان تشاينا العيانين مش العيانين بقى المساجين بريزونز كانوا اللي بيتحكم عليهم بالاعدام. بعد ما يتحكم عليهم بالاعدام ويعدموا يقوموا منزلين مفكرهم ياخدوا الكدني والليفر واخدين بالكم. فده اللي بنسميه بقى نون هارت بيتنج. طب ينفع بقى يتاخد امتى؟ في الفتره الاولانيه 5 دقائق 10 دقائق وهو كان ارستد ذير از نو هارت بيتنج. طب دي تفرق؟ اه تفرق وتفرق كتير. ليه بقى؟ لان انت لما بتاخد الاورجن على نون هارت بيتنج اول حاجه the first thing to happen is the micro vessel what's called microvascular thrombosis. Microvascular circulation thrombosis. Vessel thrombosis for microvascular circulation. قبل انت تقدر تحكم عليه. فبتبقى لها delayed complication. يجي بعد كده what's called ischemic cholangiopathy. Ischemic cholangiopathy. يجي له multiple biliary strictures which is criteria for non-heart beating liver transplant. ده لما بيجي له عيان وعنده obstructive jaundice ونعمل له ال MRCP او ال ERCP وتلاقي عنده non-anastomotic or anastomotic multiple biliary strictures اعرف على طول ان ده كان عنده ايه؟ زارع له ايه؟ ايه العضو اللي مزروع له؟ مزروع له كتافيرين non-heart beating. واخدين بالكم؟ يبقى النون هارت بيتنج ده بيؤدي الى كومبليكيشن. سو الهارت بيتنج احسن. طب ايه بقى وضع الهارت بيتنج والنون هارت بيتنج؟ احنا قلنا الاثنين دول كذبه. هول ليفر كل الليفر. طيب جم نتيجه الشورتج اوف اورجنز يعني عندنا على الويتنج ليست سي 10,000 عيان هيموتوا خلال 3 شهور دول اسمهم ويتنج ليست. يبقى 10,000 عيان هيموتوا على 3 شهور ال 10,000 اللي لازم ازرعهم، بس انت جالك 5,000 ليفر. ففكروا قالوا ايه؟ طب ما الليفر ده كبير وواسع كده، ها؟ Why we don't divide it into right loop and left loop؟ فبقى ده حاجه اسمها splitting. فمعنى السبليت جرافت يعني ايه؟ يعني الليفر بيتقسم على اثنين او اكتر، فانا بقى بفصل. اوكي، that's very good. This splitting can be done in vivo or in vitro. يعني ايه in vivo او in vitro؟ يعني اعمل splitting وانا بشيله من الكاديفا من الدونر الديد بودي ولا اعمل له splitting لما اخرجه واحطه على الترابيزه؟ تفرق؟ قالوا لك اه تفرق. فجربوها. لو لما تعمل splitting in vivo الريزلت احسن من splitting in vitro. فعندنا دلوقتي the second type is split graft. برضه split graft two types split in vivo or split in vitro. بعد كده قالوا كانوا بيعملوا حاجه اسمها auxiliary liver transplant. يعني ايه auxiliary liver transplant؟ يعني خلوا بالكم بس يفهموا النقطه دي مهمه. يعني ايه auxiliary liver؟ يعني انا هحط liver جنب الليفر القديم. اوكي سوري. اوكي ذاتس فان. Auxiliary liver transplantation. What does it mean auxiliary liver transplant? It means we are adding the liver graft along with the native liver of the patient. This is auxiliary liver transplantation. We can do it either orthotopic or heterotopic. بمعنى ايه اورثوتوبيك او هيتيروتوبيك؟ اورثوتوبيك جنب الليفر بيسايد ذا نيتيف ليفر. هيتيروتوبيك اواي فروم ذا نيتيف ليفر. This is a very peculiar. How can we do liver transplant in presence of the native liver? When should we do this procedure? They used to do it in the 80s, in 1985, 1987, and so on. In patients with fulminant liver failure. I'd like to concentrate for just 1 minute for this peculiar procedure. If you have a patient with fulminant liver failure, they used in the 80s or 90s, early 90s, they used to do auxiliary liver transplant. What does it mean? We do adding a new liver into the patient in spite of presence of the native diseased liver, which is completely necrosed. Hoping is that after 2 to 3 months, a spontaneous regeneration would happen for this totally necrosed or inflamed liver. And the patient can recover from his final liver failure. So if we can bridge this period by giving him another liver for this only 2 to 3 months, and when he comes stable and the liver biopsy shows that the native liver has recovered completely from the primary insult, at this stage you would stop immunosuppressive drugs. What would happen at that stage? The body of the patient would attack the grafted liver, leading to its complete destruction. However, we have a regenerated, already working liver, so the patient would never suffer from the side effects and the complications of immunosuppressive drugs or medication. Okay? It's a bit very strange, isn't it? Again, you have got it? So, auxiliary liver transplant, it depends on the principle that patients presented, it should be fulminant liver, it is done only in patients with fulminant liver failure, because fulminant liver would regenerate after 2 to 3 months. But the patient would not survive 2 to 3 months without liver. So we give him momentarily transient liver support by offering him auxiliary liver to cover this short interval, 2 to 3 months. What is the aim of this procedure? To encourage the native liver to regenerate, and after regeneration of the native liver, you would stop all immunosuppressive medication, resulting in complete rejection of the attached or auxiliary liver, resulting in very good condition of the patient without medication, without immunosuppressive drugs that have sometimes serious complications. If we discuss the complications, the late complications of immunosuppressive drug can sometimes be serious, can lead to de novo malignancy, can lead to renal failure or nervous complications, and so on. So this is what is meant by auxiliary. There are two types of auxiliary liver transplant. It could be orthotopic, in a sense, it is placed beside the native liver, or heterotopic. The location is away from the native liver. Okay, now we come to the commonest used liver transplant in our locality in Egypt, which is the live donor liver transplant or living donor liver transplantation. It depends on getting the right or the left lobe from healthy donor to one of his relative or non-relative. So, live donor liver transplant, it depends on getting the graft liver from a live donor, not cadaver, not heart beating or non-heart beating. No, it is a live donor. Live donor, we operate on a live donor in order to get one of his lobes, either the left or the right, depending on the anatomy, the size, the weight of the graft, and the weight of the patient, and so on. And in this procedure, we use live donor. There are two types of live donor. It could be related or non-related. Okay? What does it mean related? His son, the daughter, the brother, the cousin, sometimes the mother or the father. For children, they can donate one lobe or even one segment of their liver to their offspring or to his. And so this is what's called liver-donor related. However, there is another form which is non-related. There is no relation. The related can be blood related or emotionally related, be some emotionally involved. Yeah, in America, they have a problem. Sometimes there is no marriage certificate, and they live together, man and woman, and they call it, they are emotionally or emotionally involved or emotionally related. Their boyfriend can offer his girlfriend a part of his liver or vice versa. The girlfriend can offer, and this is another type of relation. However, we have related or unrelated. We have also anatomically, you can donate with the left lobe or the right lobe or a segment depending on the recipient weight or the recipient size. Initially, left donor liver transplant, the first ever left donor liver transplant has been reported in almost 1988 by Raya in Rio de Janeiro in Brazil. It was from a mother to her baby. Her baby had primary biliary cirrhosis, primary biliary atresia, and the mother donated by giving a left lobe. Okay? So this was the first left lobe. Afterwards, the Japanese took the other hand, and the Japanese pioneered the left donor liver transplant. However, they started their program using the left lobe. And as you know, the Japanese people or the Asian are usually small size personnel. So the left lobe was quite enough for them. However, when they tried it in America with big guns, the left lobe donation resulted in disaster because it was not sufficient tissue to support those big guys in the Western countries. So they regret again to the right lobe donation. What we do sometimes, left lobe transplant according to the size of the liver and the size of the recipient as well. The other fantastic type of liver transplant was called domino liver transplant. I'd like you to consider it for another 1 minute about this. You remember patients with amyloidosis, amyloid polyneuropathy, the liver is functioning well or not functioning well? It's functioning well, but the defect is that it secretes abnormal protein. So, what about, let us think about this, what about if we get this liver which secretes abnormal protein and give it to another patient suffering from end-stage liver failure, however, his expected survival after liver transplant is less than 5 years. How could I know that expected survival of this potential recipient is less than 5 years? Because he has advanced hepatocellular carcinoma, for example. So in domino liver transplant, they do it simultaneously. They take out the liver from the patient with hereditary amyloid polyneuropathy with a perfectly functioning liver, but it secretes abnormal protein. This abnormal protein to cause disease in the recipient, it should be more than 5 years to get the manifestation of polyneuropathy with such abnormal protein, should be 5 years or even more. So if I can offer this perfectly functioning liver to a recipient with expected post-operative survival less than 5 years, he would survive, say, for example, for 3 or 4 years without developing amyloid polyneuropathy, but at the same time, he would die from other causes, like recurrence of the primary liver disease. And in this way, I would have resolved a big issue of this group of patients who have terminal disease. So they call it domino liver transplant. I take a perfectly functioning liver from a patient with abnormal protein, but to get the manifestation of the disease, it would be more than expected survival in the potential recipient. This is what's called domino liver transplant. Is it clear?
Yes.
Yeah, that's good. The last one is the dual graft transplantation. What does it mean, dual graft? Dual graft is being invented from South Korea by Professor Lee, who is a leader of surgical technique. In South Korea, a big guy, a father, who's almost 100 kilograms, had end-stage liver disease, and he was beloved by all members of his family. He had two sisters, he has two daughters. His two daughters would like very much to donate for their father. But either of them, the graft size would be insufficient to support their father's life. So what can they do? They got out the right to from one daughter, and the other right lobe from the other daughter, sorry, the left lobe from the other daughter, and they put both grafts in the same person, which is called dual graft transplantation. It gives you hope that the brain, if you work, and if you love, you can do marvelous work, okay? I'm sorry. We have time over. I'm ready. I have no problem. If you would like to have a few slides, okay? Go ahead. What are the minimalistic criteria for liver transplant? Is every patient with acute or permanent liver failure should be listed for liver transplant? Of course not. The minimal criteria would be child who course scoring, P and C. Child who used, we used it many years, undergraduate, postgraduate, and it's well known. However, you should do everything. Patients with child A are absolute contraindication for liver transplant. مالجيش العيان عنده liver cirrhosis, مجرد ان هو بس منومجالي والالبومين بتاعه بقى 3.2 او 3.4 بتعمل له ليفر ترانسبلانت. تقول لي انا بعمل له ليفر ترانسبلانت بتعمل في ايه؟ It is absolutely contraindicated to do liver transplant for patients with a child unless he has hepatocellular carcinoma. علشان كده احنا ساعات بنعمل النتائج في hepatocellular carcinoma. على فكره the results of liver transplant for HCC in our center are excellent. Why? Because we select patients early stage of the neoplast, early stage of the liver disease, so they are almost, many of them are child A, and they have a small neoplastic lesion, they have best survival, but if there is no underlying malignancy or primary vascular carcinoma, a child who class A is absolute contraindication to do. ليه بقى؟ لأن العيان because the patient with child A expected survival is more than 10 years. Expected survival more than 10 years. However, patients with liver transplant, 5-year survival is almost 70%. And even 60%. So you would put the patient at a higher risk rather than getting a survival benefit. Okay? So this is why it's absolutely. And if we call child group B, why? Because expected survival for patients with child group class B, expected survival is almost 50% at 5 years. However, 5 years survival for post-transplant is almost 70. So you would offer them around 20-30% survival benefit. So it is indicated, okay? So minimalistic, this is the minimum, the least. MELD scoring more than 40, sometimes in other center more than 50, in other center more than 60. What about MELD score? MELD score, it stands for Mayo, Mayo Clinic End Stage Liver Disease Scoring System. So MELD scoring is an abbreviation for Mayo Clinic End Stage Liver Disease Scoring System. It was initially proposed to do, have or to determine the prognosis of patients undergoing TIPS procedure, transjugular intrahepatic corticosteroid shunting. This was the initial study published in Hepatology in 2000. But it's been validated as a prognostic factor for expected survival for patients with end-stage liver disease. And it's been also adopted in America, in the United States, in February 2002, rather than UNOS criteria, which is being used before. Anyway, MELD scoring include three parameters only: serum bilirubin, serum creatinine, and serum prothrombin converted into what's called INR, international normalized ratio. So these are the three determinants. When they developed the MELD scoring, they want to determine objectively, not subjectively, because one of the default of childhood is that you have subjective assessment if he has mild ascites, moderate ascites, or severe. If he has encephalopathy grade 1 or 2 or 3, this is a subjective assessment. That is, in America, they have denied this subjective and relied mainly or heavily on objective parameters like prothrombin time converted into INR, serum bilirubin in milligrams, or serum creatinine in milligrams as well. So if we have log multiplied by specific factors of these three parameters, we can calculate the MELD score of this patient, and accordingly, we can list him for transplant. Why it is being listed if it is more than 40 or 50 or 60? Because they found the expected survival of patients above 14 is less than patients underwent liver transplant. So you would offer him survival benefit. But if you do liver transplant for patient with low MELD scoring, you would not offer survival benefit to such a group of patients. Rather, you would put them at a higher risk of complication, even mortality. You understand this? Because patients with end-stage liver disease and the low MELD score, they have low expected mortality, okay? But the procedure itself, the liver transplant procedure itself, has a first-year mortality around 15-20%. So it is expected to live more than 1 year. If you do liver transplant, 20% of all these people would die. So why should I do it, okay? So patients with low MELD score, less than 14 or 15 at some centers, are excluded from being listed, although they are indicated for liver transplant, okay? We can, a 90% chance of surviving 1 year without liver transplant. Then patients with the child A have 90% chance. If there is an episode of spontaneous bacterial peritonitis or refractory variceal bleeding, this is an indication. If the onset of stage 2 encephalopathy or encephalopathy in a patient with pharmaceutical liver failure, okay, that's okay. So if the patient has chronic liver disease or chronic liver failure, it should be a child who B or C, or MELD score more than 14. But if the patient has pharmac liver failure, it should be, when should we do for pharmac liver failure? If he developed stage 1 or 2 hepatic encephalopathy, or sometimes clinical criteria, the offer rate if there is factor 5 and factor 7 is at 30%. As we see in this, there has been a great effort that resulted in improved post-liver transplant survival. So the first year, 1 year survival, according to the literature, range from 70% to 90%. 5 year survival, almost 80-75% probably. 10 year survival, 62%, which are great achievement in the field of liver transplantation. How could we achieve such improved survival? Because of the appropriate time of reference of the patient for liver transplant, what we have mentioned now, proper listing for the patient. We have improved the prevention and the treatment of acute cellular rejection. We have developed a new immunosuppressive drugs and medications that prevent acute cellular rejection and the graft loss. We have better prevention and treatment of infectious complications like cytomegalovirus, like pseudomonas infection, like fungal, disseminated fungal infection, using the new medication like voriconazole or amphotericin B. What are the rationale? Why should we do liver transplant? Why we got this prospect of liver donor rather than cadaveric donor liver transplant? What is the rationale? Why? Why we take a normal person and operate upon him and take off one part of his liver? Why should we do this? Because there is organ shortage, the organ pool shortage. We have on the list almost 10,000 patients, but we have only 5,000 cadaveric graft. Simply, it means we have 5,000 mortality per year. Okay, so if we can these 5,000, their relatives or other persons, live person can offer them a part of their liver, it would of course improve the survival on the waiting list. The unavailability of cadaveric organs in some countries, like in Japan, where they believe in Buddha, they also, like some Islamic countries, they don't touch dead bodies. They brought, according to religious beliefs also, in Japan, in Islamic countries, they don't operate on cadaveric bodies. Elective transplant patients before serious decomposition or death while waiting for cadaver. If you put the patient with hepatocellular carcinoma on the waiting list, and he would do liver transplant, but after 1 year, surely the tumor should have progressed at such time, and at the time allocated for this patient to do liver transplant, who would be far beyond the Milan or UCSF criteria, resulting in mortality, high mortality before and even after liver transplant. So what can we do? If you have a time, if you have a hepatocellular carcinoma and you have been allocated to do liver transplant after 1 year, you can bring one of your relatives or your brother, your sister, your wife even, to donate part of your liver, and in this way we can salvage this patient from waiting for a long time on the waiting list. Okay, so this concept should be why we do liver transplant. Maybe because people refuse to do cadaveric liver transplant, as in our country, in our nation, as in some Asian countries like Japan and Korea, they don't do cadaveric liver transplant because they believe in Buddha. Or the lack of enough organs to do this cadaveric liver transplant, as in America, because they have usually depend on cadaveric liver transplant. But the available cadaveric liver transplant is not enough for every patient with end stage liver disease. So how can you expand this pool? We can expand it by offering liver donor liver transplant. What is the rationale? Also, one of the good things about liver donor is that what's called the primary non-function graft usually it does not happen in liver donor liver transplant. What is it? Non-function graft. Primary non-function graft is that you put the graft in the recipient and you do everything okay. graft vessels, arteries, and the biliary, okay, but it will not work. Okay, this is peculiar complication. Almost always can happen in cadaveric. Rarely, if ever, reported in liver donor. So you, by doing liver donor liver transplant, you would prevent such a serious complication. Because you put the graft, but it doesn't work. What can else you do at that time? So these are the rationale. These are the advantages of liver donor liver transplant. What are the ethical considerations for a liver donor liver transplant ethics? Liver donor, is liver donor liver transplant justified or for indication which are considered contraindication for cadaveric liver transplant? Yeah. Can we do liver donor transplant for patients with advanced hepatocellular carcinoma or not? Evaluation of the donor of receiving and suffering from fulminant hepatitis should not be different from that of an elective recipient. If you have a patient who is expected to die within 2 to 3 days, you should not do in a hurry the investigation for the potential donor. In other words, you should not escape or avoid to do some investigations that would take time, because you would put the donor at greater risk of complication and even mortality. You know this? يعني ما تبقاش ظرف العيان هو اللي بيخليه تكرر في الفحوصات المتبادلة أو ما تعملهاش بدقة. متفاهمين؟ النقطة الأولانية. أوكي. The necessity to do the procedure as rapid as possible should not make the team to avoid doing specific tests and investigation for the potential donor. In order, because if you do not do this investigation, you would put the donor's life at risk, and you may lead to his complication, morbidity, or even mortality, okay? But you can have the result of this test after 2 to 3 days. Oh, you cry, but my father or my brother would die in such 2 days. What can we do? You should not avoid doing such a test at this situation. You know this? Okay? Should the donor liver transplant be limited to blood-borne relatives only? This is a great debate about it. Because they call what's called the organ traffic and the organ selling, this is not ethical. Some in some countries, like in America and Europe, if you have appointed to do liver transplant after 1 year, you would go to China and buy a liver or kidney for $60,000, for $100,000, and that's okay. Is this ethical or not?
No.
Huh?
No.
Not ethical or okay? Okay, okay, okay. Thank you very much for this. We still have many. Potential donor evaluation. I'm sorry for this. We can schedule for another lecture. If you would ask the chairman of of my department to have another lecture. Okay. Thank you for listening and interest. If anyone has a question. Okay, thanks.